This week's Torah portion begins with the rules and rituals and regulations governing childbirth. Those passages have particular resonance for me right now because my wife and I just came back from a trip to Israel. We flew there to celebrate the greatest gift that a person can possibly receive, a gift from heaven. We went to meet and greet our first granddaughter. But getting back to our Torah portion, one of those rituals governing childbirth requires the mother of a newborn, after a certain number of days, depending on whether the baby was a boy or a girl, to bring two sacrifices. The sages explain that one of them is brought to atone for any ill will that the mother may have had towards her husband and or towards God when she was suffering the pains of labor and delivery. The other one is brought to atone for the possibility that the mother may have made a vow never again to engage in intimacy with her husband. But one commentator suggests that there's another overarching lesson behind those sacrifices. And all the hubbub and confusion and sleeplessness and disruption of the family dynamic that occurs when a newborn is born, as exciting as it is, the parents, the mother and the father, may lose sight of the true goal of child rearing. We know what parents have to do when they're raising children. They have to embarrass their children early and often.
I love you, Miles.
Yeah, I know, Dad. See you Friday.
You gotta say I love you back.
Dad, are you serious?
I wanna hear it.
You wanna hear me say
I love
it?
You, Dad.
You're driving me off out of school?
I love you, Dad.
Look at this place.
Dad, I love you.
Dad, I love you.
That's a copy. Tie your shoes, please.
I'm kidding, of course. Embarrassing your children is not the goal of child rearing. And similarly, although there's nothing per se wrong with my son, the lawyer, or my daughter, the doctor, neither of those are the goal of child rearing. What is? As parents, we want to raise God-fearing children who know that no matter what, their mother and their father and God love them. No exceptions, no caveats, on their good days, on their bad days, and on everything in between. The sages of the Talmud tell us that there are three partners in the creation of a child: the mother, the father, and God. But interestingly, and unfortunately, the mother and the father may forget about God after childbirth. Before childbirth, of course they know God's involved. They're praying to Him, please give us a healthy child. And after the baby's born, they thank God. But all too often, they say goodbye to God. They don't visit Him again or bring Him into the child-rearing process until the boy's bar mitzvah or the girl's bat mitzvah. And that's a shame. And it's ironic because of those three partners, God is the only one that cannot leave and does not leave. The child, like every human being, needs God constantly for every breath that he or she takes. In the morning, we say a prayer thanking God for giving our soul back that day. When you put your head on the pillow at night, there's no guarantee that you're going to awaken the next morning. When you cross the street, there's no guarantee that you're going to make it to the other side. So God doesn't go anywhere. But just as unfortunately, parents can and often do disappear. They disappear physically or emotionally. Your kids don't need stuff. They don't need things. They need you. They need their mother and their father, as much of you as possible, for as much time as possible. We need to stuff into their psyche that they know that you and their Father in heaven will always be there for them.
Tell me something, girl. Are you happy in this modern world? Or do you need more? Is there something else you're searching for?